Welcome to day 201 of our scripture reading and daily encouragement. Today we're going to cover Psalms 116, 117, 118. Then we're going to get into Psalms 119 by covering verses 1 through 48. And then we'll jump over to the New Testament and cover 1 Corinthians chapter 3. In our last scripture reading, we discussed that Psalms 113 through 118 covers the Psalms called the Hallel. Hallel means praise. These would have been the Passover songs that Jesus and his disciples would have sang after they had the Last Supper. In Matthew 26, verse 30, it says, after they had the supper, it says, then they sang a hymn and went out to the Mount of Olives. So that would have been these Psalms, 113 through 118. So the other day, we covered 113 through 115. Today, we're going to finish up the Hallel by covering the other three, 116 through 118. Again, Hallel simply means, it's a Hebrew word that means praise. They were praising God for what he had done at Passover. In Psalms 116, there is a praise to the Lord because he listens. Think about that. This almighty God that creates everything, he listens to us. And that's what he's praising the Lord for here. He listens. He bends down and gives us his goodness and his mercy. He protects and he gives us rest. It says he protects those of childlike faith. I love that simple instruction. All I have to do is have childlike faith. All you have to do is have childlike faith. In response, God protects us. The psalmist says, I am your servant, Lord. You have freed me from my chains, and I will thank you, and I will praise your name as I obey you. And this psalm is a declaration of his goodness, his mercy, his rest, his protection, and his freedom for those that serve him, for those that thank him, that those that come to him with thanksgiving. Now, Psalms 117, it's got to be the shortest book of the Bible. Here it is in two verses. Praise the Lord, all you nations. Praise him, all you people of the earth. For his unfailing love for us is powerful. The Lord's faithfulness endures forever. Praise the Lord. That's the whole book right there. So if you're struggling, you have nothing else to say, go to Psalms 117 and read this aloud over and over to God. Praise the Lord. He's saying, everyone, all you nations, all you people there, praise the Lord. His unfailing love is powerful. His faithfulness endures forever. Praise the Lord. That's all we need, guys. What a powerful, very small book of the Bible. Now, Psalms 118 is an extension of praising him. It's the final book of the Hallel. But there's two things I want to point out from Psalms 118 that stood out to me. Number one is verse 6. It says, the Lord is for me, so I will have no fear. I'm going to read that again. The Lord is for me. The Lord is for you. So we will have no fear. What can mere people do to me? See, the psalmist is putting his entire faith, no matter the circumstance, into praising God, trusting God in times of fear, taking refuge in the protection of God. His strength and joy come out of this. And I think this is hugely important for us. There's so many verses in the Bible about fear. God doesn't want us to have fear. Satan wants us to have fear. And the psalmist is telling us here, the Lord is for me, so why would I have fear? What can mere people do to me? I think this is very powerful, a place to go to in times of struggling with fear. The second thing I want to point out, verse 22, it says, the stone that the builders rejected has now become the cornerstone. This is a prophecy. This is a prophecy about Jesus. I'm going to read it again. It says, the stone that the builders rejected has now become the cornerstone. This is a prophecy that Jesus will be rejected by the Jews, rejected by God's people, but he will actually become the cornerstone, the foundation stone of the church. This is a psalm that Jesus references in Matthew. It's not only a prophecy about him and something he references, but here's what's really cool. It's likely that Jesus sang this psalm with his disciples after the Last Supper. It's sort of like Jesus sang his own funeral song. That is crazy to me that God creates this psalm way back many, many years before Jesus would have sang this song that talked about him right before he went to the cross. See, this was, it is God's plan. So the psalmist is praising him for putting that cornerstone in place to be such an important part of the building of the church. Now, Psalms 119, you know, we have 117, the shortest book of the Bible. Now we have 119, the longest book of the Bible. We're only covering about a fourth of it today with 40-something verses. It says, joyful are those who live with integrity. Do you hear that? You can be joyful when you live with integrity. It says, joyful are those who obey God's instructions and search him with all their hearts. See, I love what we learned earlier in Psalms 118. God's for us, so why would I have fear? You want joy? Have integrity. Obey God's instructions. These are simple things that we complicate. We are the ones that overcomplicate this whole thing. The scriptures are so simple. Just do what God says and trust him. You'll have no fear. You'll have joy. You'll have strength. It says, search him with all your heart. If you're searching him with all your heart, so many blessings are going to come out of that. In verse 11, it says, I have hidden your word in my heart that I might not sin against you. I love this verse. My hope and prayer for me and you is that what we're doing by investing in reading scripture and these daily encouragements, as we study his word, we are literally hiding his word in our hearts so that we won't sin against him, so that we can change who we are. This is a beautiful thing. Father, thank you for giving us your word that we can hide in our hearts. Now, as we transition over into the New Testament, we pick up in 1 Corinthians 3. Paul is beginning to challenge these people that he's writing to. He's sort of eased into why he's writing to them, but he'll spend the rest of 1 Corinthians really challenging them to live differently. They were actually a very corrupt society, and it had crept into the church. And here he explains that he had to treat them like spiritual babies. He said, I had to talk to you as though you belonged to this world. In other words, you weren't believers. Or as though you were infants in Christ. I couldn't talk to you as I would the spiritual people. I had to give you baby milk, not solid food, because you weren't ready. He's telling them, guys, it's time to grow up. I think he would say the same thing to us. It's time to grow up. It's time to get off the baby milk. It's time to start eating real food, to get real nourishment. He challenges the Corinthians by saying, the problem is you're still not ready for solid food because you're still controlled by your sin nature. He says, you're jealous of one another. You're quarreling with each other. And then he begins to tell them, it doesn't matter. Don't quarrel over who taught you or who you're following. It doesn't matter who taught you. It doesn't matter if it was Paul or if it was Apollos, if it was someone else. I think in today's world, we can name some very well-known preachers or evangelists. He says, I planted the seed. I planted the seed. Apollos watered it, but God made it grow. In other words, I was part of the process. Apollos was part of the process, but God's the one that makes it grow. Quit trying to pick someone to follow, because God will put multiple people in your path to be a part of your growth process. It's not about one person and following everything that person says. It's about allowing God to use different people to help you be part of the growth process. He says the one who plants and the one who waters work together with the same purpose. But see, often, even us, we'll put people of influence against each other. Well, so-and-so says this, but so-and-so says this. And what are we doing? We're arguing. We're putting two people against each other that maybe God has put in our path to work together to be the seed planter and to be the seed waterer. Paul says, it doesn't matter who plants. It doesn't matter who waters. It only matters that God makes it grow. The planter and the water are working together for the same purpose. And I think that's something we need to get our arms around today as believers. Paul says, He gives another analogy. He says someone will start the foundation. So first he's used this idea of a seed being planted, water, and growing. But now he transitions to the like an analogy of a building. And he says, someone will start with a foundation. So there'll be a foundation built. Someone will start that. That's kind of like a seed planter. And then others will build on it. That's like the waterer. But he says we have to be careful that everyone who builds the foundation and everything up, it needs to be built with the words of Jesus, not with our own thoughts, not with our own ideas, not with our own agendas. And unfortunately, we see that in our world where people will talk about Jesus because they want to use Jesus to get something for themselves. As Paul expands on the analogy of the builder, he says the builder can use many different materials. But the builder needs to be careful that those materials will stand up to the fire. In other words, if I were to build with stone or with gold, that will stand up to the fire. And that would be building with the words of Jesus. But if I were to build with straw, hay, my own agenda, that's not going to stand up to the fire. So in other words, choose wisely what you build with. Build with scripture, not man-made ideas. If I'm using scripture to convince you to give to our ministry so that I can go buy a helicopter, I'm being extreme here, that is not building the right foundation or with the right building blocks. Paul says that we should be all working together to make up the temple of God because the Holy Spirit lives in each of us. So he's proposing this thought, this idea, this fact that now the Holy Spirit lives in us. So instead of having this big physical temple that they would go to, like they did in Jerusalem before Jesus, instead of going to this temple where the Spirit of God lived, now Jesus has died, he has ascended, he has been raised, he has ascended, and the Holy Spirit lives in each of us, so we each become the temple, and that's very important because each of us is our own small temple, so to speak, and we need to work together because together we make up the big temple. And we should protect our temples. We should help each other protect their temples since we are to work together. Quit working against each other and work together. He's telling them to grow up. Quit acting like they're wise by the world standard. It's time to take this seriously and mature as believers. And I think Paul would have the same message for us today. So many people follow a particular pastor or church leader instead of learning scripture for themselves and seeing that that person is just part of their process. So many people follow a denomination or a doctrine instead of learning scripture for themselves. And that pastor may be a great planter, and that's good. That church or denomination or doctrine may be the water, and that's good. But we got to remember that God is the grower. Jesus is the foundation, that cornerstone we talked about in Psalms. Guys, it's time for us to mature in our understanding of Jesus. And I'm encouraged, and I hope you are too, because I believe that's what we're doing as we go through this scripture. We're not putting man-made ideas around it. I'm not asking you to follow me. I'm asking you to follow Jesus, the cornerstone. It's time for us to grow up, get off the baby milk, and eat the solid food. And I believe that's what you're doing. And I hope that encourages you. Stick with it. Keep doing it and keep growing in your maturity so that we can all work together and we can all be a part of each other's seed planting, water spreading, and allow God to grow us into something very beautiful. The world needs us today. I hope you're encouraged today, and I hope you have a great day.